Non ho aperto, c'è che non te. Oh, I can't. Really? Okay. Just want to go into Jetson's email. Okay. Haven't heard from him, but so I'll just wait. Hi, Bill.
There we go. Now you can hear me. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm doing well. Okay, make sure we are
Yeah,
set up
let's
here properly.
get here.
I
Oh,
have
here.
both the AI reading, recording, and the video recording set as well.
Sounds good. Yep, I'm just
Yes.
making sure I got some decent lighting in here. And yeah,
Okay.
I think we're good.
Okay. Good. Well, so what I'm going to do is just introduce you
Sure.
and have you tell your story, and then we'll go through just a series of questions, just have a general conversation. I was thinking, I know this is recording, so I can edit it
You can
later, but
edit. Yep.
I was thinking later, I said, wouldn't it be nice for Bill's students to have an opportunity to call in and ask questions? So we do the follow-up. We can definitely do that, create a
Oh,
platform
cool.
for that. I would love that.
Yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah. I went back through my emails and we were actually talking about interviewing you in October, but then things, October of 2022,
Oh,
but then
wow.
things begin to change at Judson's. So I
Yeah.
was sure what I was authorized to do. I just didn't know. But I do want to ask you, as I'm introducing you, I know that we're doing the adjunct advantage, or do you want me to introduce you under the umbrella of just Professor William Hines?
Sure, that sounds great.
Okay. All right. All right. I just wanted to make sure I had those things in place. I tried to re release the newsletter today. I ran into some obstacles with the Harvard Business Review article. And so that link, so so
Yeah.
I'm working on that, but it has to be released today because by end of day or tonight, because I said September 8th. So drives
Gotcha.
me crazy when I don't meet my deadlines.
And what is that? Is that going to show up in my or in everybody's inbox?
Yes.
Cool.
Yes, and I did change it. I changed it quite a bit. I changed the format quite a bit.
I'm looking forward to seeing that. It's going to be great.
It's pretty simple, but it's something I think we can build on, right? And another thing I want to share with you before we get started is that as I was thinking about the adjunct advantage, I said, wouldn't it be interesting since we are a consortium, if we could have our own consortium of adjunct professors and build out that model so we become the experts on LinkedIn. Oh my goodness, I was thinking about all those things.
There's
How
a
to
lot of
build
companies.
up that model. Yeah. So if we can become the experts, because a lot of people need that information. It's just not out there.
Yeah, we can absolutely build a LinkedIn subgroup that we can invite or accept invitations, or accept people to come into that, is just our community of adjuncts over the over time that we start collecting and having them. Yeah, that's possible.
Yeah, I was thinking about that. I said, oh my goodness, this could
Yeah.
really grow. And I'm always very careful of what I can do under the Judson banner and what I can do independently because in my mind, I have lots of ideas and I just go after it. But I have to be cognizant of the fact of who I'm representing at what time.
Sure, that makes sense.
Yeah. All right. So let's get started.
Sounds good.
I'll do my introduction. Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Karen Love, and I am the program chair for the Business Administration program at Judson University in Elgin, Illinois. Over the years, I have dabbled into inviting professionals to the platform to talk about organizational leadership. And we've had TED Talk professionals from different industries, but now I'm going to hone in on the adjunct professors. Adjunct professors bring a wealth of knowledge and practical skills to the students, and their voices need to be heard. So it is my mission to get that information out there to the public. As of today, we have established a newspaper called The Adjunct Advantage. And so we will definitely keep the LinkedIn community informed as to the development of this group of scholarly and brilliant individuals to come together and bring their expertise to build a platform with the purpose of professional development and leadership and driving students to become more competitive in the market, so the marketplace, and good citizens as well. So tonight I want you to meet the maestro in the world of project management, design thinking, web development, Scrum, and teaching. With an unparalleled passion for guiding students towards success, Professor Bill Hines has mastered the art of imparting knowledge and skills in these diverse fields. Armed with extensive industry expertise and a deep understanding of cutting-edge technology, this remarkable young man is a beacon of wisdom for aspiring professionals. Welcome, Professor Hines.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Love. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yes, thank you for taking your time, just taking a moment and having this conversation about what's going on in the education world and what's going on in the industry. So, you have such a wealth of knowledge. I just want to just share with the audience your educational background, if I may.
Sure.
Professor Hines is an adjunct professor at Judson University in Elgin and Aurora University in Aurora, Illinois. He received his bachelor's degree from Judson University in management and leadership and his master's degree in business administration at Benedictine University. He is a PMP certified individual. He's certified as a Scrum Master. He's certified in Lean Six Sigma Yellow Belt. He is also certified in design thinking at MIT, and I'm a little biased toward that because I just finished that certification, and also ITIL at Navistar. He serves in many capacities with Judson as well as Aurora University. At Judson University, he is a course writer. He teaches in presentation teaching, mentorship, Moodle, and Blackboard. In the MBA program, he teaches operations and project management, strategy and leadership, as well as the undergraduate program where he teaches managerial communications, project management, design thinking, and marketing analytics. At Aurora University, he teaches in the MBA program. He teaches project management, and in the undergraduate program, he teaches digital marketing and analytics. He also served in the U.S. military, so thank you, sir, for your service in the U.S. Marine Corps as well, in logistics. He, as a transportation and logistics specialist, skills developed there with leadership, mentorship, logistics, planning, and transportation. So, Professor Hines, thank you so much for just taking a moment again to come to the platform. So if you don't mind, who is Professor William Hines?
Yeah, thank you so much. Again, a pleasure to be here, humbled to be a part of this experience. And yeah, a little bit about me. So you basically gave my background pretty well, but you know, I've been in a lot of places and doing a lot of different things over the years. I've honed my career, my professional career, by never really staying in one place really, really long. You know, I've gotten some pretty long stints at different companies, longest being around 10 years with Navistar. You mentioned that company in your intro. And I work there as a project management manager of an office within IT. And, you know, it's basically something I'm passionate about. I didn't always start off in project management. You know, some people, when they come out of high school and they know exactly what they want to do, and they go pursue those degrees and they go and work in those fields. And, you know, my journey was a little different. I got out of high school. I wasn't quite certain exactly what I wanted to do. And the Marine Corps made sense to me at the time. So I did that. But, you know, kind of getting through my first 3 to 4 years there, I decided, you know, I was going to go back to school and earn a degree. And I was really interested in computers. So software development, computers, web development, things like that. So I decided to go after more of a business degree, you know, more of that bachelor's of arts in business. And at the same time, I was pursuing technical jobs. So one of my first jobs coming out was in sales support, kind of working with a company called Wallace Computer Services, where I was working with them to do software, a little bit of software development. It was weird because it wasn't like, you know, programming, but it was configuration of a tool and working with logos and making systems kind of work and providing some customer support, some technical stuff. And from there, I kind of grew into a what they call a product manager role. So I was actually kind of like in sales, traveling the country in the Northeast Territory specifically to basically sell barcode labeling systems to potential customers. But it was around that time when I started really getting into web development and web design, some programming. And so I pursued a career outside of that place with another company where I could actually do that. And that company was Weber Marketing Systems. And I was hired in as an application developer. And so I started for about 3 years. I worked on, you know, different kinds of applications, writing custom apps for barcode labeling systems, using touchscreen devices. You know, it was cutting edge back then. Touchscreen wasn't, you know, wasn't a thing that was all over the place. So it was pretty cutting edge. But so I did that for about 3 years, and it was around that time that I really started to discover project management. I had some friends that influenced me in my decision to kind of move in that direction. I really enjoyed managing projects and programs and working with people and having, you know, different communications like that. So I decided to pursue that and went all in, finished up my degree, like you said, at Judson, got a PMP certification. Kind of went on to get an MBA and just kind of stayed in that project management space. I've been married for 31 years this October. I have two daughters. One is studying to be a teacher at ISU. Another one is figuring out a career possibly in physics, which is really exciting. So yeah, I've got a lot of, I wear a lot of different hats, and I wouldn't trade any single one of them.
Yes, as I'm reading your resume, you wear multiple hats, but they're multiple iterations of excellence for sure. I went back to my design thinking class at MIT, and one of the exercises we had to engage in was to look at, first of all, we had to develop a product, right? We had to look at the customer survey and identify not just the needs, so or the immediacy of the needs, but some of the latent needs that's displayed through our observation, right? And so you are teaching at a university. What would be some of the latent needs you may have identified over the years?
No, that's a terrific question, and totally agree with that. These are the things that the needs that people don't outright express verbally, or needs that kind of they don't even sometimes recognize that they have. And so, design thinking course and the process, and the mentality really is all around experience, and it's all around, failing and failing fast and giving people the opportunity to do things that you observe. The key thing that I remember about that course and just in general about design thinking is, this is what I love about it, is that you can observe people in their natural habitat, if you will. And when you start to observe them, they don't tell you these things, they just do these things.
Yes.
And then when you start to observe that, you realize, wow, that's an unmet need, that's an opportunity, or that is something they would never have vocalized that we need to consider when we're designing a new product or a new service. And so valuable to watch that, to experience that, to create customer journey maps that kind of walk through the highs and the lows.
Yes.
You can truly understand what is going on with the people that you're designing for. I think that the thing I love the most about design thinking is the part is about, it's all about empathy, right? And empathy for the people that you're designing the product or the service for. If you're designing the product or service to make money and that's your sole purpose, it's you're missing something. You got to be designing the product and the service that people desire, have a need for, whether it's expressed or not, and fill that need. So I love that. That's great.
Well, it's really interesting because with the customer journey map, you have to identify the pain points. And as I was reflecting on that, I thought about the students, like our students in the adult education program, for example. We know the end point is to receive their diploma, but those pain points, what's in the middle? Like you said, what are the untold stories and how do we identify those? How do we flush those out or suss those out so that we can get them to the next level with less obstacles?
Of course, yeah.
Yeah. So that was one of the things in design thinking I thought about a lot with our students. What was your final project?
So it's funny, I actually took that course alongside a program chair at Judson, Dr. Michelle Kilbourn. We took it
My
together.
goodness.
So
Oh, excellent.
I'm pretty sure it's been a while since I've taken that course, but I believe we were creating an app. And I can't remember exactly what the app was at this point because we didn't actually launch anything. But it was really fun to exercise the process, to work with a team of people that you really don't know very well, that you have to kind of work with to get to know pretty well to pass the course, as you know. But it's all those things. It's basically being able to work on something that's tangible, work on something that's real. And that's what I think we need to bring back to our students, right? It's one thing to, give a reading assignment and then give them homework to do. But if you actually give them a tangible, like this is a real thing you could work on,
Yes.
then they start learning because they have to apply it. And when they start learning to apply, they learn. And that's the key. And so taking design thinking and thinking about that course, I bring that mentality into all my classes and all my courses, and I try to find something real that the students can latch on to, work on, and develop as part of the learning process.
Yeah, it has, you have to have that element of experientiality, and it has to be experiential, right? It's interesting. Our final project was a financial literacy app, and that was a lot of fun. We had the intentions of just surveying the Navajo tribe, but we ran into some obstacles. Then we focused on football players. Yeah, the importance of financial literacy. And we actually identified some of the ancillary customers that would have been involved in the process, such as the parents, right? So we had to go back and revamp, but it was a great exercise. And you're right, design thinking is everywhere. It is everywhere in this process. So let me just ask you some questions because we could be talking about design thinking throughout this interview. So teaching is a valuable skill in project management. And so how have you used your teaching online to train and mentor your students?
Yeah, absolutely. So project management affords you a lot of opportunities to exercise your teaching skills. So the reverse, you can go, whenever you start up a project, you're going to have business users as well as maybe even some technical folks that don't know everything about how project management works. Sometimes you'll be exercising a methodology or a framework that the business team or the technical team isn't familiar with. And so you will, at the beginning of the project, really have to take some time and teach them more about the framework and the methodology so that you can then be productive in the project so that there's no misunderstandings or surprises or missed expectations. And I think that when I approach the students coming from a project management background, one of the traits that is sort of inherent to most project managers is just organizational skill. And always being prepared. And so whenever I go to a classroom and I'm getting ready to teach, that project management side of me would have already kicked in. I would have been more than prepared for the full night's work. I would know exactly what I want to talk about, what exercises I want to go through, and always looking for opportunities to improve, what worked and what didn't work with that classroom meeting that night, so that the next time we do it, we're more successful. And that's a project manager's mindset. The planning, the organization, the preparation. And the other thing is, I think it's really critical that instructors approach that classroom with an understanding, with empathy, realizing that those students, they have personal lives as well. They have emotional situations going on. They have a lot of things, and you owe it to them to provide the best possible classroom environment, free of obstacles, free of just challenges from a technical perspective, to enable them just to learn and to interact and to grow in a way that they wanted to when they first signed up. So I feel personally morally obligated to those students to make sure that we do that for them.
Now we have gone from stages, we were sages on stage to facilitators in the classroom or the online environment. How has that impacted your teaching methodology?
Yeah, so that
Oh.
is great. That is a great question. So, when you have that face-to-face time, obviously that interaction and that ability to read the room and to kind of see what's working and not working, sometimes that's invaluable because you can make adjustments. When you're online, you don't always get that relationship building face-to-face time. But there's a few things that instructors like myself and others can do. And it's as simple as saying, you don't have to attend a Zoom meeting, but if you want to attend a Zoom meeting, I would love to go through the course with you and make sure you don't have any questions. And you can establish office hours that are, on camera, off camera, depending upon how the student feels about it. But you can absolutely set up those meetings as an instructor who's leading an online course and still get that face-to-face time that I think is invaluable to both the instructor and the student.
Bill, would you consider your students or the students at Jetson and Aurora, could you consider them as part of a product life cycle? And if so, how is that manifested? How do you identify the stakeholders? Even you have the immediacy of the students, but even from an ancillary perspective, who are the additional stakeholders?
Yeah, no, they absolutely you could look at it that way. And where are they at? When you think about the marketing funnel, right? And you think about what are the stages that a person goes through to actually commit, make a purchase, and exit the funnel. What happens when they exit, right? So these students, they are in that funnel, if you will, and they're in that place where they've already decided and committed to the program. And are paying their tuition and are taking those classes. And the thing that we have to be really, really on top of is the fact that, our brand, our school, our reputation is literally online. It's on the line because these students, through word of mouth or through social media, will have good things and bad things to say. And so it's going to be really important that we give them that experience that they so much desire. The reason why they're there is to learn and to learn a lot, and to have instructors and professors that are, there for them, that want to talk to them, that want to teach them, and that want to help them. And if they feel all that, chances are when they exit the funnel, or they become, they become graduates and alumni, that they remember their time at the university as something really positive, and that they would tell everyone and anyone that they should also enroll and go through that program. And that's what you want. That's what you're aiming for. And it's every single instructor's job, I believe, to make sure that happens. And we don't often get to meet all of one another, like all the instructors don't, get together all the time, but we're all playing a part of that. And so I think it's imperative that we realize that our success is their success, their success is our success. They fail, we fail. And we don't want to see that.
And that's interesting because we have to move away from commoditizing our students and realize that they are human beings and we need that human-centric approach. We live on a church campus, and so on 31. And so every car that passes this church has a story to tell. Every person that turns into the parking lot has a story to tell. There's a testimony there. And we have to be protective of our image, our brand. And sometimes it's difficult because not everybody has buy-in. Sometimes a contract is a contract. Adjuncts can be affiliates, they could be contingency, they could be part-time instructors, but that buy-in into the mission and vision of the institution, because everyone has a story to tell.
Sure.
Thank you for sharing that. Let's talk about risk management, how that is crucial to project management. So how do you mitigate, first of all, identify and then mitigate potential risk in your projects?
Yeah, it's a really great question. Risk management and issue management are kind of brothers and sisters, if you will. Usually issues don't just come up. Usually there's some warning signs that things in a project are going to go sideways or go wrong. And so you can usually identify the common things that go wrong way ahead of even the project start. So there's things like, you're going to lose key team members, or, we didn't budget enough for this particular part of the project. And so there's some basic, whenever a project manager kicks off a project and we go through a gate review, I take a look at the risk log. And if nothing's identified, that's usually a warning sign that they really haven't thought hard about all the things that could potentially go wrong. So it starts at the beginning. The project manager really meets with the team and says, what are all the things that you think we need to watch out for? What are all the bad things that could possibly happen? And so when we identify those things, we then try to score them in terms of, this might happen, but it probably won't, right? Or we score them as such as this might happen, or it probably will happen. And if it does happen, it's really bad. And so when we do that, we get a score that says this is a higher level risk than these other ones. We need to mitigate that. We need to do something about it. So at that point, the project manager and the team can look for contingency plans or solutions so that risk never becomes an issue. And when it does become an issue, that's when the project will go over budget. That's when the project will not be finished on time. And that's when the product quality will suffer. You'll have to take something out of scope that you didn't want to take out of scope that you wanted included, and you're just going to have to cut corners to get there. And so it all starts with what could go wrong and what could we do about it now so that it doesn't. And then if it does go wrong, okay, what are we going to do about it? How do we handle that when it does happen?
All right, so let's transfer that into our student enrollment and what that looks like with recruitment or retention and the application of project management, what would you look out for?
So it transfers really well. I mean, when you're talking about risk management, it could be risks to your house, your car, your job, your project. Risk knows no particular subject. So, when it comes to students, there are things there that you need to watch out for. Is the student, attentive in class? Is the student arriving late and leaving early? Is the student kind of not paying attention and just looking at their phones or looking at their laptops? And these are opportunities that, we can inject ourselves into that and say, hey, I noticed, you do take a break and say, hey, I noticed, during the course you were a little distracted and, what's going on? What's happening in your life, right? Is there anything I can help with? And that's what opens that door of communication, I think. And people start to open up and you become more real to them and they become more real to you. Like you said at the beginning, we cannot commoditize our students. They are people. And so everyone comes to the classroom with something. And so I think then you look at, the assignments and what they're turning in, and if they're not turning something in, what's going on there. So it's really important to intervene quickly. You'll notice behaviors pretty fast, usually by the first end of the first night, first week into the second. And it's right then and there that you have to raise that flag and talk to that student and then connect them with a success coach, right? And say, look, I'm seeing something here. I don't know if other instructors have seen it, but this is what I'm seeing. So that we don't lose them. So that and I don't think if they're showing up, they want to be there. They do want to finish. So it's a matter of not being afraid to raise your hand and say, I think I see something that and the student needs some help.
Very human-centric approach. Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, collaboration and teamwork plays a significant role in project management as well. How do you foster collaboration and ensure effective teamwork among project team members?
That's a great question, and I'll also answer it in the way that I do it in the classroom. So, on a team, on a project, in a classroom, it's all people. It's all just people, and so people will open up. People will work together. People will ask questions. People will raise their opinions if they feel that they're in a trusted environment. You need to establish trust. Pretty quickly in the classroom. We only have so many weeks to really engage our students. And sometimes it's just being vulnerable, right? So I've found what really works well is just being vulnerable and just, saying, look, I had a bad day today and here's what happened. And I'm really struggling with, this or that. And telling a true, real story. And then the students are like, well, wow, if the professor feels that way and they're having a bad day, I guess it's okay if I have a bad day too, and I can talk about it. And they'll tell you about it and they'll come to you and they'll say, what you said really resonated. And so it's the same thing in the corporate world, with projects, people, you treat them with kindness, you treat them as you would want to be treated. You respect them, you remain professional with them, and you basically become vulnerable. And if you become vulnerable, they will trust you. And when they trust you, they will work for you. They will go to bat for you. They will ask you questions. They will raise their hand. They won't be afraid to say something's right or something's wrong. They will, it's just going to lead to just a higher performing team in a classroom.
Now, how does that translate in an online environment?
Yeah, and so that's tricky, right? Because typically when you're online, you don't get that face to face. And so that's where I think, the instructor needs to basically reach out to the students and say, let's connect if you want, right? Because you can't, if it's an online class, there's some level of restriction there where you can't force them to come and be with you at a certain time. But if you open yourself up and multiple times, throughout the week, give them an option, they might join. And if they join, don't jump right into like the material. Start with a human story and start talking about, Judson a little bit, or talk about your life and what's going on. You don't have to tell them all your whole life story, but just come off as human and be a little bit vulnerable. And even in those online settings and situations, they will respond. The other opportunity we have online is responding to discussion boards and discussion board posts. And as they put themselves out there, and respond to a question, you have the opportunity to respond back to them.
Yes.
And so in doing that, you know, that is another form of dialogue that you can engage in, that you can share some of your personal experience and be a little bit vulnerable so that they come out of their shell a little bit and feel comfortable and trusted, and more trust, so that they open up.
Yeah, it's interesting that the students, once they respond, they move on to the next question. And so when the instructor responds, their question, should I respond again? Will I receive credit for that?
Right.
But to engage in ongoing dialogue, that just helps facilitates the development of the student and the knowledge they will gain from the class. But it doesn't happen all the time, unless it's emphasized at the beginning of the term.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's where I think, you know, things get a little wonky when we start counting words, right? So if, you know,
yes.
if you're responding to a discussion board post and, you know, the student responds and gives you a one word answer, it's, you know, sure, I'm going to go back to the student and say, you know, can you expound on that a little bit? Because that's a little bit short. But I think when we get into a transactional relationship, if you will, with, you know, discussion board posts and with assignments, you know, then I think we're losing, and it doesn't make sense because we're not engaging in the way that we should be on those discussion boards. Because if they want to get out fully what they want out of these courses, they really got to invest their time, their thoughts, their energy, give it everything they got, and the instructor will respond to that. We see the impassioned, you know, blog post about, you know, whatever the topic was, and it's something that really resonates. I'll respond to that and be like, that was a really great insight, and here's what I think, right? So that's where we got to get to. We got to get away from being transactional and more toward meaningful content being written that they really feel strongly about and that they're passionate about.
Thank you. Let's continue with that. How do you encourage that culture of learning and innovation with the students and the instructors as well? What's your advice?
Yeah, I think you got to relate back to the real world, right? So if they're studying, you have to first kind of find out what is it that they're interested in doing. Some of them don't know. Some of them want to move up, but they don't quite know where they want to move. And so as you're talking about, you know, corporate life, if that's where you're coming from, or you own a business, or, you know, you work in the service industry, maybe you're a firefighter or you're a police officer, the more you relate to them what is going on in the day-to-day in that world, and the more you tie back those assignments and those readings and different things back to the real world, that gives them thoughts and ideas around, okay, maybe that's a career I'm interested in. I know that I'm successful in a course not by the survey that comes back saying that, you know, Bill was a great instructor or Bill wasn't a great instructor. I know I'm successful when the student comes up to me and says, I want to learn more about project management. I want to do what you do. That tells me that, okay, I've made that connection. They understand what this is. They're excited about it. They've got a new road to go down. And by the way, I'm someone who can help, right? Because I'm in that field. I know a lot of people, and I can, and hopefully connect them with a job if they're interested in doing that. So that's what we got to do. That's where we got to get to. That's ultimately what they're trying to do.
Yes, yes. The demographics has changed quite a bit because we had students come in, adult students that were employed at that time. But because of the economy and COVID, things have really changed in the economy, and they may be looking for a new career.
Right. Absolutely. And that's where we got to have that, you know, empathy and we make those connections, right? Because today, you know, you might be the instructor that has a job and, you know, maybe you're teaching classes on the side, and tomorrow you might be the one who's looking for a role somewhere. And those students that you helped mentor and grow and build that strong relationship with, they might be looking out for you at that point. It's amazing what happens when you make these connections and what can possibly come of them. It's truly amazing.
Yeah. Bill, in 2020, we went through such a cultural disruption and COVID, the pandemic, everything was very challenging to the university. One of my students, a white male, came to me and he says, I want to talk to you. I trust you. I don't understand this dynamic. I'm being accused of being someone I am not. And so how do I how do I approach these things? How do I process these things? Because all of a sudden my identity has been questioned. Did you have conversations like that or similar to that?
Well, I've, been in those situations where, someone at work, is upset about, maybe your management style or, they're not doing so well. And unfortunately, when you're in a leadership role, you do have to give bad performance reviews. And sometimes, unfortunately, you do have to let people go. And I did have a situation where I was accused of something I didn't do. And, today in corporate America, it's scary because, regardless of whether or not you did it, there has to be an investigation. And these
Yes.
things do need to be looked into. And so, but if you've done everything and you've not done anything wrong and you've got really great documentation and you're well respected and regarded, that will come through. The truth will always set you free, if you will. That will come through. And there's no way. If you didn't do it, those false accusations won't stick and they'll get to the bottom of it. So you just got to trust the process and trust the system. But it is difficult. I think that we live in a very litigious time, and we live in a time when it's us versus them, and I can't wait for it to pass. But we just have to keep the faith and realize that it is just now. It won't be forever. It will pass, and when it
Yes.
does, we'll be stronger for it.
Yes. Well, one last thing. You want to share your personal statement in terms of your classroom engagement and teaching role, and your work in academic pursuits, your multiplicity of responsibilities. So I'd like you to speak to that because I think that is so important for the audience to hear
Oh, for
who you are.
sure.
Yes.
Yeah, I'd love to. So, something I'm very passionate about is teaching. I have a lot of empathy towards my students who, are working and they're going to school. As an adjunct, adjunct professor, I'm deeply passionate about it. I look at every classroom as an opportunity for engagement. It's really a seminal moment. It's a point in where we change lives, where we shape lives both at Judson, especially academically and spiritually. And so
Yes.
I consider, my role as not just a, a contract obligation that I'm fulfilling, but, there's a bigger purpose there. And committing to guiding the intellectual and the emotional growth of young adults and older adults and students in general, I think it's just humbling. And it's really something that you can't take lightly as an instructor. I really feel like my job, one of my jobs is to make sure that I've removed as many impediments to learning as possible. And that means, preparing. That means knowing the subject matter, preparing for the course, making sure that the online e-learn course is all ready for them to go, making sure there's no broken links and everybody understands what is expected of them, that the technology is working and it's user friendly, and let's just knock all that stuff out so that they can just focus on learning and getting their stuff done. I have a personal mantra, and it kind of probably came out in this interview that if they're failing, we're also failing. It's an
Absolutely.
investment, right, that we make in our students. And it's success and failure goes both ways. It's not just a one-way street. So I feel that failure really is not an option, and we're on this shared academic journey together. We're in it together. And so my philosophy is it underpins this symbiotic relationship, I think, which is rooted in a mutual respect for the folks that are coming back, because I've been there myself as well, students sitting in their seat. And just, an understanding of what that looks like and what that feels like and how hard that is. And I always think about, they're coming here because they're in pursuit of something that they're trying to achieve to improve their lives. And that one achievement that they make gets passed on to the next and the next generation and the kids that watch their parents go to school at night and try to get those degrees done, they're going to be inspired by that. They're going to
Yes.
be like, well, if my mom did it or my dad did it, I can do it. And so that's what I want. I want, you know, them to be successful. I'm deeply passionate about it. I love doing it. They say that, you know, when you've found something that you love, it doesn't feel like work. And I'm telling you, every time I get in that classroom, it does not feel like work. So that's how I
Amen.
know I'm in the right place.
Well, we definitely understand your loyalty because with the fluctuation of enrollment and everything, all the challenges that comes with it, you have been a stalwart and you've demonstrated time and time again how much you love the institution, you love your students, and you love your profession. So I thank you for sharing your pursuit of excellence with all of us at Judson University.
It's been a humbling experience, and I thank you for
Yes.
the time.
Yeah, very good. Okay. So I'm going to stop the recording and we can have a chat. I'm gonna have a much more professional ending. I
No, sounds great.
promise
No worries.
that.